Good afternoon, everyone. I mean, good morning. Sorry. I was going ahead to my Apple talk, huh? Well, what I'm going to do is talk with you today, show you some of the results of a two-year study on managing peach bacterial spot. Okay. And we had basically two objectives. It was done in 2016 and 2017. The first objective was to evaluate the efficacy of kasugamycin and compared to the copper and oxytetracycline standards. I'm not sure if any of you are aware, kasugamycin is a relatively new antibiotic that was registered for control of fire blight on apples as a product called Casamin by Arista Life Sciences. And the package was into the EPA for also getting it registered for peach bacterial spot. However, that got held up. However, IR4 is going to be finally finishing the registration this year, so we may have it available later in the year or certainly next year. So the question is, how good is kasugamycin? How does it compare to what we're currently using? And then the second objective was to try to time these applications according to weather events rather than the calendar. Try to be a little bit more exacting, perhaps get better control that way. And then this year, or I should say 2017, we added a couple additional objectives. We wanted to examine the kasugamycin plus Captan. There was some evidence that Captan gives it a little bit of a boost in efficacy, so we thought we'd look at that. And then we also wanted to look at this new SAR material, systemic acquired resistance material, called Lifeguard from Certis. It's Bacillus mycoides. It's an actual biological agent. It does not actually control bacterial spot directly. What it does is it induces resistance in the plant. So if it can reduce resistance, then obviously that's how we'll get control. So here are the treatments that we had for this study. And you can see up on top here, we have, try to get this to, oh, there we go. There's our copper standards coside at 1.7 ounce per acre, and that gives us a half an ounce of copper per acre. That's equivalent to the old 10 cop standard, which was 8 fluid ounces to the acre. That's the same amount of copper as that. Okay, and that was applied chuck split through 10th cover, so we're just using that straight through. And then Fireline is the same. Of course, you could use MicroShield as well. That's oxytetracycline, 1.5 pound per acre, all the way straight through. Then here's our experimentals. There's the Casamin being applied with Regulade all the way through as well. Casamin plus the Captan. And then here's the Lifeguard alone. And we also had a Lifeguard alternating with Coside just as another thing to compare and look at. All right, so the timing rules that we used for application, we applied our very first application at about 5% chuck split. Some people might call this late petal fall, but that would be the first spray. And then we would monitor what we're calling the daily rainfall probability, or DRP, the percent chance of rain. So this is the same thing that you would see if you go online and look at either AccuWeather and Telecast is what we use, the Weather Channel. They always give you the percent chance of rain tomorrow and the next day. So we look 2 days ahead, so we see what that percent chance is, because that gives us tomorrow to put the spray on in advance of the rain. All right, so we monitor that. If it's less than 50% chance, then we're going to spray at 10-day intervals. That's like our default. Normally, bactericide sprays are put on weekly, so we're trying to stretch it out, so we're going to make it 10 days. If the DRP is greater than or equal to 50%, now we want to monitor our time since the last spray. This is just the number of days, that's the D there, since the last spray. Okay. Now, if that is less than 5 days, then we're not going to spray. In other words, basically we're going to say is once we put a spray on, we got 4 days that we're covered, and then we're going to start looking at whether or not we need to do the next spray, okay? Which is a bit of a stretch probably for the antibiotic, not so much for the copper, but anyway, that's what we're going with in this model. If the time since the last spray is greater than or equal to 5 or less than 7, meaning that it's either 5 or 6 days since the last spray, and the DRP is greater than or equal to 70%, then we're going to spray. And then the other scenario is, if it's greater than 7 days since the last spray and we have greater than or equal to 50% chance of rain, we're going to spray. And then once we do the spray, we go right back up to the top and we start monitoring the DRP for our next spray. Okay, and we know we got like 4 days off, so we don't have to fool around with that because of this, interval here. Okay, so that's the program that we followed in both years to try to time things according to the weather, and particularly rainfall. Okay, so let's look at fruit infection at harvest. And for our dependent variable, we came up with market grades. Okay, and this was done with our New Jersey growers setting these different grades. And so for market grade one, if our total lesion area is less than or equal to an eighth of an inch in diameter, then that would be our highest quality fruit, okay, our grade one. If that total lesion area is greater than an eighth but less than 3/16, then you don't have a single lesion greater than an eighth of a diameter, that's grade two, so it's a little bit lower quality. And then their culled fruit would be everything else. If it's greater than 3/16 inch diameter and or you have a single lesion that's greater than an eighth of an inch, okay, then that's culled and not used at all or sold at all. Okay, so that's how we graded our fruit or how we did our disease assessment. Okay, so here's 2016 results. And this is the highest quality fruit, grade one fruit. And you can see the cosine and the fire line, no significant difference. Now we want higher numbers here, right? Because this is percent fruit in grade one. So we want higher numbers or better. And you can see that the Castleman wasn't quite as good as the two standards as far as grade one is concerned. Okay, and we had, and if we didn't do any spraying at all, we still got 35% fruit in grade one. So not too bad, actually. So that tells us that it wasn't too severe an epidemic in 2016. However, in 2017, we only had 10% of the fruit if we didn't do any spraying, so obviously a much more severe epidemic. And you, however, the Castleman this year was as good as the fire line and the coastside, as you can see here. When we added Captain to the Castleman, it got a little bit of a bump there, but not much, not significantly so. The Lifeguard by itself did not do anything. Okay, so that's indicating it's not activating any resistance in the host or the tree. However, when we alternated the spraying the Lifeguard with the coastside, it did as good as all the other treatments, which was really a bit of a strange thing, because this coastside up here is every single spray. This is every other spray. You wouldn't think that would do as good as that. So is there something going on between the COSOD and the Lifeguard? Are they acting together some way? The other way to explain that is maybe we didn't need to do all of these sprays, and so every other spray here with the COSOD being the only active is what was giving us the control. All right, the only way to know that for sure would be to have a COSOD that only had these every other sprays, and that's all it had, right? Then we could figure it out what's going on, but we can't do it with that. All right, now let's look at grade two. In 2016, we had basically no significant difference between our two standards. The Castleman did have more. Now, obviously, we don't want to maximize grade two, right? We want to maximize grade one. So this is not necessarily a good thing to have high amounts of grade two. However, we did have more grade two there than we did here. In 2017, that did not occur. There was no difference between the three. And the same thing with all the treatments, actually, were not significantly different from each other, and a good number of them were also not different from the control. Not too concerned about that, because like I said, we're not trying to maximize grade two, all right? Now, the other thing we could look at is the combination, right? Because the combination of grade one and grade two is total saleable fruit. And this is kind of interesting here, because there's the red is the grade one, the proportion is grade one, and then the blue is the grade two. And you can see that because the Castleman had more grade two than the coastline fire line, it actually caught up, so to speak, in terms of total saleable fruit to the other two. And so there was no significant difference in total saleable fruit. So, oh, all right, well, that's good. So we were getting some more enough control where we could increase our grade two. Now, if you look at 2017, no significant difference between all three. So that kind of mimicked what we saw when we looked at just grade one. And again, the epidemic was much more severe in 2017, only 17% total saleable versus 54 in 2016. Now, when we added the Captain, again, we got a bit of a bump, but it wasn't significant. Lifeguard by itself, not significantly different from the control, so it doesn't seem to be doing anything on its own, but there it is again, alternating with the coastside, and we're getting no significant difference. It's doing as well as these treatments. So that needs to be obviously still figured out what's going on there. All right, now the real question here, and you're probably wondering, this is sort of like the elephant in the room. Obviously, we got a whole lot less saleable fruit here than we did here, right? It's about half as much. All right, so what's going on there, right? Whatever happened, it had an effect that was equal across the board, right? Because all three of these were reduced in a similar fashion from here, right? Okay, but before we get into the possible causes of that, because I don't know the answer, but I'll show you a couple possible causes, let's talk about just the conclusions that we can make from looking at the results within each year. All right, so for Kasugamycin or Casumin, it was nearly as effective as the Pharolin and the Cosine. You saw that it was pretty darn close. All right, equivalent amount of total saleable fruits, although the proportion of grade 1 fruit was significantly lower in one of the 2 years. So in that year, your total value was actually a little bit lower because you didn't have as much grade 1, right? Because grade 1 would sell more than grade 2. Now, I didn't show you this, but we have not seen any foliar disease control at all out of the Kasugamycin. Now, in 2016, when we had the less severe epidemic, both the Pharolin and the Cosine gave us foliar disease control. The Kasugamycin, nothing. It was just like the control. However, in 2017, when we had the more severe epidemic, none of them worked for foliar disease control. So, on the heavy epidemic, it's really tough controlling foliar diseases, foliar bacterial spot, I should say. Okay, so what I would recommend, when it does become registered, that we deploy the Kasugamycin in combination with a copper in order to pick up some of the foliar disease control. That would probably be the way to use it. If it continues to show that we're not getting that foliar control, I only got that 1 year, so we need to look at it a little bit more. And then the thing to do would be to alternate that with the Pharolin and MycoShield. So that would give us essentially three different chemistries, because these two antibiotics, the Kasugamycin and the oxytetracycline, are not cross-sensitive in terms of resistance management. They're not cross-resistant. And of course, copper acts differently, so all three of those would be together act as a good resistance management strategy. Okay, what about the Kasugamycin plus Captan? Well, we did see that's a slight boost, 8% more saleable fruit than Casumin alone. However, it wasn't significant, so we do need to do some more testing to see if there is any real true benefit from that, from adding the Captan in there. If it is real, what is the mechanism? Well, one idea is that the Captan actually helps the Kasugamycin to get into the bacterial cell where it can be more active. It's actually allowing it to penetrate and get into the cell. That's just one form of possible mechanism. All right, what about the Bacillus mycoides? Well, we saw that it was ineffective in inducing the resistance in the tree. Now, keep in mind, this is a highly susceptible Henry peach that we don't really grow here. It's a California variety. They grow out there. We don't grow it because it's too susceptible. It's good guinea pig for me to do these studies, okay? But the fact that it's highly susceptible may mean that there is no gene for resistance in there that could be activated, right? So if we had, a moderately susceptible variety, maybe the LifeGuard would work on that. See, so we need to still look at LifeGuard on some other varieties. But as far as the O'Henry's concerned, or highly susceptible, it doesn't seem to be doing the thing. However, this is really interesting, and I didn't show you this either, and that is, fortunately, because we had that Captan out in that treatment, we were able to look at scab control, and we got 70% control of scab with the LifeGuard, okay? And the reason why we knew to do this is because LifeGuard was shown to control pecan scab, which is a related pathogen to peach scab. Same genus, Fusocladium, but a different species. So I thought, well, hey, it's worth looking at. And when we did, not even trying to control the scab, we got 70% control. That also indicates that the titer, or the concentration in the tissue, was high enough to activate the resistance for scab control. All right, which also tells us, okay, it got in there, but obviously there was nothing to activate for backspot, but there was for scab. So this is really interesting, because now we're talking about a fungal disease. What does it do for brown rot? I mean, there could be all kinds of ramifications where we could use LifeGuard to basically make some of these different cultivars resistant. So that's a whole different thing going on there. Okay, now getting back to that elephant in the room. Okay, we had the same timing rules in both years, but we only had about 50% as much saleable fruit in 2017. So what happened? What are the possible causes? Well, the most obvious one is that we just had a control failure under high disease pressure. This happens, you know, even with fungicides. You get into a year where just extremely high level amount of disease, and it's like nothing can hold it back. And it happens more likely, actually, with bactericides than fungicides. A lot of our fungicides can take I can get, you know, 95 to 100% control under for brown rot under very heavy disease pressure and still get that level of control. That's not going to happen with something like bacterial spot. All right. And we know this is true because we were looking at, last year we looked at disease progress for bacterial spot on non-sprayed trees. So here's percent infected fruit, and that's the blue curve. Okay, so you can see that the epidemic began about early May, went up nice sigmoid here, went up to about 90% fruit infected by the end of June. So that was our epidemic last year, and this is, and then the red is the number of lesions per fruit, and you can see a very similar pattern, got up to about 18 lesions per fruit. And I can tell you based on that severity measure that this was, it was a severe epidemic, but it wasn't like super severe, because we've had hundreds of lesions on fruit, so 18 is not actually very high, but it is more severe than it was in 2016. Now, we didn't do the disease progress in 2016, but we did rate the amount of disease at the end of the epidemic, and this is what we had. There's the amount of disease percent infected in 2016 at the end, and there is the number of lesions per fruit. But we do have to do a correction here, because in 2017 we were a whole week ahead of schedule. You know, we had a warmer spring. So if we correct by moving those values 7 days earlier, okay. But even so, when we compare this to this, obviously much less severe here than there. Same thing if we want to look at the number of lesions per fruit. We only had about maybe two or three here versus that looks like maybe around 17, 18, somewhere in there. So clearly much more severe disease in 2017. And that may be one possible cause for the lack of control. All right, another possible cause is the timing rules. They did not account for rainfall amounts or temperature. Now, I thought this was, well, I'll get to it in a minute here. I was going to say something else. All right, so let's look at some of the detail now for these, for the spray rules that we followed. Here are the different spray periods. So the suck split to first cover spray period was 5 days long in 2016. First cover to second cover, 8 days long. Second to third, 7 days long. So if you take all of those and you get the average, we were spraying almost weekly, right? Every 7.2 days. But look what happened in 2017. We weren't getting as frequent a rain period. The rain periods weren't as frequent. So we were spraying at the default of 10 days, most of these. This happened because we had too windy to get out there. We had to wait another 2 days before it calmed down. That would have been 10. Here's one that we did spray a little bit earlier, but the average still ended up being 10. Now, this doesn't mean that this is the same period of time as this, okay? Except there are two fewer sprays. But it's the same time period, only because, remember, we're stretching them out more, right? So we covered the same amount of time, but fewer sprays. All right, so let's look at the frequency, the number of rains greater than a tenth of an inch. If we look at these first couple here, we can see we had one during this period. We had four rain periods there, four here, four, three, one, one. So clearly, we had a whole lot more rain events in 2016 than 2017, which explains why we had fewer sprays, right? We were stretching them out because we were looking at number of rain events, all right? And we had a total of seven fewer rain events during the same time period. And some of these up front here, only one there and there. Now, what did we not include in our rules-based model? Well, we didn't look at the total amount of rainfall, and here's where I want to get back to. When I walked in, there was someone up here, she left, I think, that was talking about how we're getting more deluge of rainfall, right? Bigger, heavier rains. Well, this is exactly evidence of that. Look at this here, 0.52, 1.02. Now, this one is higher than that one, but look at that, especially that one there, okay? There's a little bit higher down here, but anyway, our total here is higher than there, particularly in the beginning for these four. Let's see, I think I've got a, yeah, okay. And obviously, you know, we're going to get more washing effect. We're going to lose our residue faster if we have heavier rains. So that's something that's not in there. Maybe that was a factor. And let's look at this particular in more detail, this one right here, because it's a big difference. If we say day zero is when we put our third cover spray on. That's the spray there at the beginning of that interval, right? Okay. Then the very next day after that, we had 2.92 inches. Then on day three, right after that, we had another 0.08, Okay, here's day four, 1.42. Now remember, we're not going to spray for 4 days. So we're good according to that model there, right? And then on the very last day, this 0.24 inches actually occurred early in the morning. It was an extension of this day four. Okay, so we couldn't even come in there and spray if we wanted to. But the bottom line is we after this very first spray, we probably didn't have any residue left. I mean, that's a lot of rain. Okay. So could this have been the difference between the very high amount of saleable fruit in 2016 and the low in 2017? Well, yes and no, because this particular one, this occurred about midway up that disease progress curve. We were already on the way up before this even occurred. Okay, so I think it's not too likely that actually is the difference. It could be a factor, but it wasn't the only factor. Then the final thing to look at is temperature. We don't have temperature in that rules-based model. However, if we look at, again, these four, look at this difference here and how much warmer it was in 2017. Remember I said it was an earlier year in 2017. It warmed up a lot quicker. Well, this difference here can make a world of difference in terms of multiplication of the bacteria. Therefore, that much more inoculum. So the temperature could have been a big factor, and this is, we're talking here, the beginning of the epidemic too. So that could be even a bigger factor than the amount of rainfall. Then the final possible cause I want to throw out there is maybe we had a large amount of primary inoculum beginning of 2017 versus 2016, okay? And by that I mean we had many overwintering cankers. These are the overwintering cankers. This is sort of blackened area here. Okay, it's called a spring canker. The infection occurred in the fall, usually through the leaf scars, and then the following year it starts to develop. And so this canker is loaded with bacteria. All right. So if we had more of those, obviously we're gonna have a whole lot more inoculum that's gonna start that epidemic in early May. And also it's possible that the weather was maybe more favorable in 2017. For buildup of that inoculum, or a combination of these two, okay? And so here's my last, or next to the last slide here. This is average monthly temperature for January, February, March, and April, okay? There's the average temperature for the 30-year normal, 2016 and 2017. And you can see the temperature's going up and up, and I'm sure if I added this year's on there, it'd probably be even higher for the next year, right? The exception was March. Last year we had a little bit of a correction. It got cool and that slowed us down, but we were still ahead last year than we were in 2016. But if we look at April, it went back up compared to the... So this is kind of the new world that we're living in, where things keep getting warmer and warmer, okay? Well, if we just simply get the average, okay, of these 4 months, it was 40.3 for the 30-year normal, 42.5 for 2016, 44.8 for 2017. And so you can see that it's obviously getting warmer and warmer. However, these particular 3 months, especially these temperatures, this is really too cold for the bacteria to multiply. Not a whole lot's going to happen there, okay? This one's kind of getting there, but still, this is really where I think the increase occurred if that was a factor in last year's epidemic. That's a 6-degree difference there. And if we look at the highs for those three cases, we can see that we had a lot high. Now we're getting up almost near 70. Okay, and we're going to get a whole lot more bacterial multiplication in those cankers, and a whole lot more inoculum. And that was the month right before the epidemic began in early May, right? So to me, that's where it all probably happened, you know, if the inoculum, primary inoculum, was a factor. So that's it for my results. Now, Mike wanted me to give you some, all right, what are the recommendations that I, and I'll give you recommendations without casugamycin because I already mentioned that. Okay. So what I generally recommend is an integrated program between copper and oxytetracycline. And so you want to start your sprays at less than 5% chuck split, or what we call late petal fall. We want to alternate the sprays between copper and the oxytetracycline. And so those are the same rates I showed you earlier. So this is exactly what you were seeing in our two standards, except we're putting them together in the same program. And ideally, if you can, you want to try to time your oxytetracycline space to within 24 hours of the rain, preferably before. All right, because it has a very short residual. It's not going to be around for days. And that's something we can certainly consider to do in our model, is shorten that from 4 days maybe down to 2 or something like that. So now, the advantage of this program is that by having it integrated between these two, we are going to get some phytotoxicity from the copper. You are going to drop leaves. You are going to get lesions on the leaves. As a matter of fact, when you start spraying copper on your trees, if after three sprays you don't see any little red round lesions developing on your leaves, you're probably not putting on enough. You could use that as a guide, all right, in terms of controlling bacterial spot. The key is not putting on so much copper that your new leaves start, your leaves are falling off at a rate faster, okay, than they are forming. As long as your shoot can stay ahead, because the older leaves are less important photosynthetically anyway, and those are the ones that got disease first and they'll drop the quickest. All right, so you'll want to keep that shoot growing and essentially outgrow the copper. So by having the oxytetracycline in there every other spray, that really slows that process down, allows you to control that growth, that effect of phytotoxicity of foliar leaf drop more exactly. The other thing it does is, of course, the oxytetracycline is more expensive than the copper. So by having the copper with the oxytet, you're cutting the cost down. Now, if you really want to cut costs down, the other one that I do recommend for the cost conscious is a straight copper program. Okay, again, you begin at less than 5% shuck split, and you just do weekly sprays at that half ounce copper per acre. Now, if a significant rainfall is going to be expected within 24 hours, and the WW here has nothing to do with the web, that's windy, warm, and wet. Okay, so those are the three things you got to look for, right? Wind conditions to blow the bacteria around, warm so that they multiply, and wet so that they can move into the plant, into the tissue, the fruit, or the leaves. Okay, so under those circumstances, if that's happening, you can increase up to 1 ounce, and I have data that clearly shows that as you increase the rate of copper, you get better and better control. The problem is we run into is we start dropping all our leaves, so we can't do that a lot, but an occasional increase to 1 ounce will give you that little extra boost right before that important infection period. The other thing you can do is instead of doing that, you can come in with an antibiotic. And obviously, if you're trying to, you know, come into a low-cost program, then you wouldn't be using these as often just to keep the cost down. So, okay. And then, of course, as I indicated earlier, there are some ways that we can integrate casugamycin into that program once it becomes available. So, that's it. Oh, good. Almost on time here. I'll be happy to entertain any questions, and I will be here for lunch because I'll be with you again after on apples. So we can talk during lunch as well. Jerry?
On your lifeguard, do you see any phytotoxicity, or how does it work with the coside in terms of phytotoxicity? Does it reduce the coside phytotoxicity when you add the lifeguard?
Yeah, anytime you reduce... It's almost a direct relationship. Anytime you reduce the number of copper sprays, it's less phytotoxicity. I mean, it's pretty straightforward. So by just doing it every other spray, it's just like that one program where I had the oxytet alternating with the coside, right? If you had lifeguard alternating with the coside, you're going to get that same benefit of reduced phyto. Yeah. The problem, of course, with that one was that we saw on lifeguard alone we weren't getting any benefits, so we're not sure what it's doing in the mixture. And obviously, I would not want to recommend that mixture if it really truly wasn't doing anything in the mixture. So we need to figure out, maybe we only needed to apply coside every other spray and that would have given us as good a control.
When you use the isomycin, did you get any phyto with that, any leaf phyto?
We saw that on one variety, I think it was on Bounty. And I don't know whether or not they're gonna have a warning on the label. I don't think anybody else saw that, I'm pretty sure it was from the casugamycin because we didn't have a whole lot of other things. We had insecticides that were being applied to those trees, but yeah. But nothing on the O'Henry and trying to think what some of the other varieties. There were three of us that were evaluating the efficacy of the casugamycin working with IR4. Myself, Carrie Peters, you know Carrie, and then Jim Adiskavich out of University of California, Davis. And I think I was the only one that saw that effect. So there were other varieties that were, you know, that was sprayed on.